The number one reason people seek out the data from F4S is to be able to identify and unlock high performance in their teams. Now, this could be a startup or a high growth venture, or it could be corporate enterprise customers using F4S to build high performing teams. What I'm about to share with you is the research findings from multiple studies and from the data inside of our platform of thousands and thousands of teams for the key characteristics that distinguish high-performing teams from low-performing teams. Now, my guess is that you're like so many of the folk that we initially work with, and that is, I bet that you think that the two critical distinguishing factors in the individuals inside of your teams are their functional skills and their functional experience. No doubt you troll LinkedIn or their CV, you do reference checks, no doubt you might even do some challenges when you're hiring people to test their skills. Now, there is no doubt that they're important factors, yet, what I'm about to share with you is they are not the X factors. I'm about to share with you the findings that we have that are those X factors. Now, the X factors relate to what we call in our data motivational traits or motivational biases. A motivational bias you might also refer to as an attitude or a filter or a preference for how you like to go about your work. Now, when we look at the most highly transferable things when it comes to teaming, is actually someone's attitude and motivation at work. Now, what is often a blind spot for most hiring team members or leaders and managers when they're curating their ideal team is that they focus on those hard technical skills, and they forget that even if you've got the best hard technical skills, if the attitudes don't align with the performance and task, with the team culture, and with the actual goal and the objective of that team, no matter how technically skilled or how much experience they have, that team will get into gridlock, the team dynamics will cause them to fail, and overall the project will actually fail. Now, my sense is that if you're watching this video, you've experienced that from time to time or you regularly experience in your team. Now, one of the first factors is most people want to hire for cultural fit. Now, in our definitions of what makes cultural fit, we're looking for the most diverse teams that are aligned with the performance of the team, so therefore the project that the team's setting out to do. We want to go for the most diverse teams that actually have the most cognitive diversity, not only the other forms of diversity of gender, of race, of age, and all of those other critical factors. The research shows that the most diverse teams are more successful. Now, when we're looking at what we mean by cognitive diversity, we're again coming back to these motivational biases, or what we might call attitude styles and filters. In one of our studies that we conducted in 2016 and 2018, what we found was is that those high-performing teams in startups and high-growth ventures actually have different cognitive biases to those of the corporate enterprise teams. I'm about to share with you two of those critical findings. We found that high growth startup teams have a motivational bias for what we refer to as initiation. It's a proactivity to quickly turn your ideas into action. Successful teams, comparatively to the executive and corporate teams, successful startup teams, they have a 30 to 40% higher bias for the speed at which they turn their ideas into action. So what that means is there's no reflecting, there's no waiting, there's no patience, there is just the impetus to take the first step, to initiate the phone call, to set up the project team, to plan or whatever the activity actually is of the very first step. The impetus here is to take the first step, even if it's the wrong step, to learn from that and take a new step and a new step and a new step versus reflecting, pausing and waiting for the right time to act, which is more of the bias in the successful corporate executive teams, which could include getting all the stakeholders on board, soliciting the ideas before taking action. So as we can see, different biases for a different environment leading to different performance and different results. That's one motivational bias. The second motivational bias is what we refer to as big picture abstract thinking. This was statistically significant finding in terms of the number of rounds of investment that the high growth venture achieved, in terms of the scale and the size of the venture based on the number of employees, and also based on the ambition of the venture versus it being a local or national business versus being global first ventures. Now, what we found is that this motivational bias was a critical ingredient in both corporate executive leadership of high-performing teams in corporate enterprises, but also in the startup high-growth ventures. We found it was, though, 20 to 30% higher in the high-performing teams in high-growth ventures. Now, we found two additional motivational biases that are found actually correlated with failure of the team. Now, the first one is what we refer to as structure. Now, structure in F4S data terms measures your unconscious motivational bias towards organizing, planning all the resources before starting the project. Now, in corporate executive teams, we found that a slightly higher bias was found than the rest of the executive workforce for the high-performing teams, which means in corporate enterprise teams, there's more organizing all of the parts, and having a well-formed plan before stepping off to embark upon doing the actual project. The opposite is true in startup high-growth ventures. What we found is that a super low bias, nearly 50% lower than the rest of the executive workforce, corporate enterprise teams, was the success factor for our high-performing startup high-growth teams. That means a very low focus on structure, which means improvising and figuring things out and experimenting as people go, not needing the plan before starting the actual project. Now, we found that low structure was the success factor correlated with successful early stage venture success. We found that counterintuitively, that high structure, so the need for more planning before experimenting and validating ideas, was actually correlated with early stage venture failure. So low performing, failing teams. So we're looking at just only four factors here, and immediately we can see some of the critical findings from the research. To illuminate the fourth factor is a focus on detail. Now, what we found in our high-performing corporate executive teams is that they have kind of an average focus on what we refer to as detail. So detail is being concrete, specific, getting into the nuts and bolts of what, when, how, and with. It means needing to get the concrete understanding of something before getting the gist of it. Whereas those focuses, we already said, with the big picture, they don't need the detail, they move much more quickly. Now, what we found in our high growth ventures, we actually found that high detail at the same level as a corporate executive team member is actually correlated in an early stage startup venture with venture failure. So again, failed team. So when you step back and see that in both of these examples of failure with the structure and the detail, that these attitudes and motivational biases in a corporate enterprise environment are actually key success factors. So when we look at these, what we can see is that even with the right experience and the right technical skills from a functional level to be able to do the functional skills, which might be being a software engineer, which might be doing sales and selling, which might be doing customer service, the technical skills and experience, that if we transport these individuals from one environment of corporate enterprise teaming into startup, high growth teaming, that those motivational biases could cause the team to fail. And so what we know is figuring out what are the specific motivational biases for specific team performance is the key ingredient that allows teams in all sorts of environments to thrive. Now, one of the things we know is that some team members will be task orientated. They want to get the job done, focus on the tasks. Some team members are going to want to be relationally orientated, focusing on the relationships and the people in the team or the people in the project. Now, as we step back from that, sometimes, very unusually, people have both of these biases. But more often than not, these biases will be one or the other. And in that case, we can sometimes expect way too much from team members, expecting them to have all of these biases and fail to actually construct a team around the genius and the talents of the individuals. So what we've learned from our data sets is that the most high performing, the most successful teams are diverse from a cognitive diversity standpoint, from diversity and inclusion, so gender, race, age, etc. And they also have diversity based on playing to and placing people in roles that play to people's natural motivational biases. Now, I'm going to give you a really concrete example of what that looks like. My motivational bias in one context is that I'm super high on what we refer to as external reference. If you've watched any of my other videos, you will have heard about my big learning. Is that as a professional coach of coaching for around 23 years, my number one kind of focus and mission is I want you to author, I want you to narrate your own decisions in your own life. So it means that I'm very high on what we measure in F4S as what we call external reference, versus what would be called internal reference. Internal reference is measuring my own criteria, my own values and beliefs, and then imposing those on other people. Now, in the coaching context, this is an absolute significant strength for me, right? It helps me to thrive and to love what I do, but importantly, it helps me to perform at my best because I'm not going to impose my ideals on you. I'm going to help you to explore, figure them out, and actually author your life and your decisions. Now, when you transport me into our startup high growth team, Fingerprint for Success, a tech company, my external reference as a founder of that company is too high. I'm too inclusive, wanting everybody else to contribute to the ideas. And what we know from our research findings, that high external reference is correlated with early stage venture failure. And I've had some bumps along the way that related to that. So what I've had to learn is to be able to increase my internal reference, reduce that external reference in order for me to be thriving and be successful in Fingerprint for Success. And so that's been challenging at times, it's been counterintuitive, but what's super cool is armed with that self-awareness, I can actually pick that up, figure it out, and not have to go through all of the hardship of a complete failure. Now, when we add people into the team, if we choose people who naturally have a bias for whatever it is, whether it be people, whether it be task, it means that we can put them into a role that they're naturally motivated by. Have you ever seen how demotivated a task-orientated person is if you ask them to sit down, do one-on-ones all day, help people with their performance, coach them on the job, figure out all of those aspects versus getting on with the task at hand and doing the task? And conversely, if someone's super motivated by people and you ask them to only do task-based work, how drained they become, how demotivated they come. Now, in our data sets, we measure 48 different motivations at work. One of them is people and one of them is task orientation. And we're able to see how motivated they are for that. So armed with that, you can use that and align people into functional roles inside of the team that actually aligns with what they're passionate about, what gives them energy. We know from our data sets and from our research that where you have a low motivation, it means that you get drained and lose energy from those areas. Now, it doesn't mean that you're not good at them. So someone who's low on detail doesn't mean that they're not going to be good at detail. I happen to be low on detail and I can be one of the most anally retentive, detailed orientated people because in past roles I've had to develop that competency and that expertise. But if I spend a full day or longer in a role where I need to do a lot of detailed work consistently and consecutively, I actually go home exhausted at the end of the day. And now each one of us has many different motivational biases where that's the case for us. Now, the science towards high-performing teams is having individuals inside the functional roles in the team that are aligned with their motivational bias. We're looking for skills, we're looking for experience, but the big X factor is having someone in a role that's aligned with their motivations. And when they're aligned with their motivations, they're creative, they are thriving, they're at their best, And importantly, they're satisfied and fulfilled at work. When we know when people are fulfilled, they get into states of flow or states of genius. The flow state is labeled by Csikszentmihalyi, a Hungarian biologist who was looking at peak performers. And so we're gonna have more peak performers if we match people into roles where they're mostly spending their time aligned with their motivational bias. So, when we're looking at high-performing teams, we want to look at the functional roles. We want to make sure that we've got people in roles that play to their natural motivational biases, and we want to make sure that we've got diversity in the team. The idea of cultural fit is really important from the standpoint, are the individual's values aligned with the organisation? But if we have individuals who are all clones of the leaders in the business, we are going to have groupthink. We're going to be moving more towards the concept of maybe a cult, not intentionally and not at the extreme, but moving towards everybody thinking the same way. The most creativity, the most innovation, and what our research finds is that diversity in a team of ideas, of gender, of age, of race, all the other different permutations of accessibility allows teams to be the most high performing. So the big question is what are your motivational biases outside of what you first consciously know? What about those of your team? How unconsciously are you hiring to just match what you know and what you're drawn to? And if you were able to tweak your team members so that they were in roles that is aligned to their motivations, what would that unlock in your current team? So I invite you to step back, think about current teams, think about future teams, and of course you can jump right on into Fingerprint for Success, take our people analytics assessment. It will take you between 15 minutes and around 30 minutes, and immediately you'll have what we call your fingerprint of your natural motivations, what you're high on, what you're low on, what those benchmark against in terms of high performance, and importantly you can bring your team in and get to see their motivational biases and start to unlock and detect why some team members are not performing in specific tasks and what you can do to tweak and unlock incredible energy, focus, and performance in your teams.